Are toxic boundaries controlling your life? Let's dig into the truth about toxic boundaries and how they mess with your mental and physical health. Together, we're going to learn some practical tips on how to reclaim our peace today. It's a quiet Tuesday afternoon. Linda's in her kitchen, leaning over her sink, trying to relieve the nagging back pain in her mid-back. She works nearly full-time, but that's not where the real exhaustion comes from. It's her days off. It's on these days where she watches her grandkids for free, a task she loves, but it takes a toll on her physically. Just as she tries to catch a moment's rest, she hears that familiar ping from her phone. It's the daily message she dreads from her daughter-in-law asking for a later pickup time. Linda braces herself against the counter to text her reply. She shakes her head in disbelief. Her son and daughter-in-law know that she struggles after 3 p.m. with her back pain, yet they still ask for more. Linda's fingers land on the keyboard. Slowly, as if under duress, she pecks out the reply. Sure, no problem. This is Linda's story. So what are toxic boundaries? If you're like me, you might think, well, they're boundaries that manipulate and control other people. But when I started researching for this episode, I was shocked to find out toxic boundaries are basically anything that's unhealthy. Do you remember Goldilocks and Three Bears? Well, boundaries are kind of like that. They're either too rigid, too porous, or they're just right. Linda's boundaries, well, they're too porous. She loves her grandkids and wants to help out her son and daughter-in-law, but she's compromising her own health and well-being. She's stuck in the cycle we're probably all too familiar with people-pleasing, and she can't break free. Let's break this down even further. A rigid boundary might look like a mother-in-law who insists on maintaining a perfectly clean home. Like, everything has to just be perfect. She might say, I love having you over, but don't touch anything in the living room. Well, this rigidity can hinder the bonding process between her and her grandkids. On the other hand, porous boundaries might involve agreeing to activities that exhaust you because you just can't say no. Imagine the daughter-in-law that always agrees to host events even though they make her physically ill. She might say, sure, I can host Thanksgiving again while suffering through migraines for days afterwards. And then we have those in the middle, healthy boundaries. They allow for flexibility and respect of both your needs and the needs of others. They protect your well-being while fostering healthy relationships. Think about your boundaries. Are they too rigid? Are they too porous? Or are they just right? So Linda's willingness to push past her physical limits and put herself in extraordinary amounts of pain, well, this stems from her childhood. She grew up in a home where her feelings did not matter. Her dad was a yeller, it got worse when he drank, and her mom, she was consumed with making her dad happy, often at the expense of herself. So this is what Linda learned really young, is like putting everyone else's needs above your own, like that just kept the peace. So that was her MO, just do everything for everybody else. Now, all Linda has are her adult kids and grandkids, and she would just die if her grandkids were pulled away. So she just bears it. But deep down, when she allows herself to really think about it, she feels like she betrays herself on a daily basis. On the babysitting front, Linda is not alone. Many grandparents have turned into free daycare providers in their golden years. It's estimated that 70% of new moms are in the workforce, which has led many parents to rely on grandparents for childcare. But the benefits package goes well beyond the extra giggles and snuggles with their grandkids. A study showed that grandparents who occasionally babysit live longer, with a 37% reduction rate in all-cause mortality over the course of a 20-year period compared to grandparents who don't babysit. That's all great and all, but Linda really needs to learn how to balance, otherwise she is on the road to burnout, and then she'll never even get to experience those benefits down the road. Before we dive into the signs of toxic boundaries, if you're new to the channel, hello, let me welcome you. My name is Jess. I'm a boundary freak. I think boundaries can fix almost everything. If that is an interest of you, please hit that subscribe button and stick around. So what are some signs of toxic boundaries? Well, let's look at this through Linda's situation. First, the guilt for saying no. So for Linda, the thought of saying no is too uncomfortable, even though it's detrimental to her health. Second, she prioritizes others over herself. She is constantly putting her daughter-in-law's needs over her own, which leads to physical pain and emotional exhaustion. And finally, feeling resentful and drained. That's Linda, all right? She has no energy at the end of the day, and the resentment, that is quickly moving in. How about you check in? Have you ever felt guilty for saying no? Like, just drop a hand emoji if you are, so we can all just feel like, yeah, we're not alone. I struggled with this for a very very long time. And it was my husband who taught me that it's okay to say no to things that don't fill my cup. So then I had time for things that really mattered to me, like spending time with my family, making memories with my kids, just like being with my family. Like quality time is my thing. And he's the one that inspired me to say no, push through the guilt. But I have to be honest, like the guilt, the boundary guilt is still there, but at least I know it's temporary. Back to the story. One evening, Linda was sitting at the kitchen table, icing her back, staring at the clock, ticking closer and closer to bedtime. She's fighting back tears as she just dreads tomorrow. Just another round of entitled requests that she feels honestly required to comply with. It's in this moment of pure exhaustion that she says, "Something's gotta change." She just reflects on her physical pain and the emotional toll it's taking on her. Like her back pain is becoming unbearable, and she can feel the sinkhole of resentment widening between her and her daughter-in-law. Oh my gosh, I just wanna give Linda a hug, rub her back, maybe put some icy hot on there and talk to her about healthy boundaries. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about setting and maintaining healthy boundaries for your well-being. Here are some practical tips to help you set boundaries that work for you and your relationships. Number one, identify your needs. The first step in setting boundaries is understanding your own needs and wants. So for Linda, she needs to recognize that she has to rest and prioritize your own health. So if we're going to go through this exercise, looking at it like through Linda's lens, she would realize in this step that she needs to set a specific end time to babysitting to manage her back pain effectively. Here's a pro tip that I did in the beginning is I would write down all of my needs on one side. And then on the other side, I would write down how I felt when I didn't get my needs met. I mean, this made it so clear what boundaries I had to set like that. And I think that would really be helpful for you as well. Now it's your turn. Tell us in the comments, if you took a step back, thought about what you needed, what boundaries do you know? Like it's hit you like a ton of bricks, or maybe you've known for a while. What boundaries do you need to set, or you've identified that you need to set in your life? Like put those in there so we can kind of help hold you accountable and we can be a community of support for you. For example, maybe you need quiet time in the morning. That's me. Maybe you need some alone time after social events. That's my husband. Or perhaps you value teamwork and so you require your whole family to pitch in when it comes to housework. We do that as well in our family. Step number two, communicate your needs clearly. Once you've identified your needs, you gotta tell the people that it's gonna impact. So Linda needs to talk directly to her daughter-in-law about her limits. So for example, Linda could say, "I love spending time with my grandkids, but I can only babysit until 3 p.m. because after that, my back pain becomes too much to handle." I don't know about you, but when I first started, I practiced rehearsing my boundary, like before I would communicate it to the person. So I just felt more confident and like it would just roll off my tongue because I was already gonna be nervous setting the boundary. And so having it rehearsed, it just came out more like smooth. But how about you? Like, do you rehearse when you set a boundary or do you just wing it? Number three, practice saying no. Learning to say no is a vital part of setting boundaries. It can be challenging, especially if you're used to pleasing others for a really long time, but it's essential for all your health, mental, emotional, and physical health. So for Linda, she needs to practice saying no to additional babysitting hours. So holding the line, "I'm sorry, but I can't babysit past 3 p.m. I'm just no good to the kids and I need to take care of my health." Like I said, I used to struggle with saying no and sometimes I still do depending on the person asking because I just don't want to disappoint anybody. But over time, I realized that that discomfort of saying no does pass, like this too shall pass. And hopefully that helps you like just get the courage to try it. And I tried with like little things first. Like, so I would say no to very little things at first, and I would gradually move to bigger things like once I gained more confidence, but just keep meditating on the fact that this too shall pass. Also, the boundary guilt we feel when we say no, it just means we care. It just means, I would always remind myself, it's just meaning that I'm a good person. Finally, step number four, seek support. This is the most overlooked step, but it's so important. Surround yourself with people who respect your boundaries and can offer support. For Linda, this might be a best friend. This could be a support group. This could be a pastor, a counselor, a therapist, or maybe a group like a knitting group in her community, but she feels like she can actually talk to them and they can give her some good advice. So let's say Linda chose a close friend about her struggles and she gets advice on setting boundaries. She could say, "Betsy, I'm finding it so hard to say no to my family's demands. Can we talk about ways that I can manage this better?" So for me, my person was my husband. Out of all the books I have read, he taught me that I matter, like that I have value and that I can say no to things that don't fill me up, that I can live a life aligned with my values. And like I've alluded to, my values are making memories with my family. Just him giving me permission and really showing me that, like, yes, I have worth and value and I can set limits around me so that I protect my time and resources. Maybe I just needed that, so that he was my person. So whenever I'm stuck on something, whether it's my mom, whether it's a business thing or something else, I'll just run the scenario past him on like what he would do or what I should do. And he helps me by bringing it back to my values, like what aligns with my values. And then I make a decision based on that. And just having that support is super helpful. You could consider joining a support group, even the MYB community, like actually engage with these podcasts and put your story, put your questions out there for other people to comment. That's where you would get your support in this community. But you could also get yourself a counselor, talk to your pastor, or talk to a trusted friend. So who is your go-to person? Is it your spouse? Is it your best friend? Do you have a pastor, a therapist? Who is it? Like, let us know and give other people some ideas on, you know, maybe it's your sister. Just give us ideas on who is your person. And then that might be give somebody else like, oh yeah, I could ask my aunt to be my person. Let's get back to Linda's story. One day after another late pickup, Linda finally had the courage to muster up a talk with her daughter-in-law. She just explained the physical pain and the strain that she's under every single time she gets done babysitting. Now, Linda's daughter-in-law listened, but she was definitely reluctant. Obviously she was like living the dream, but they did agree to a specific pickup time. Now, this was the first step for Linda to set healthier boundaries. And after the talk, Linda felt a mixture of relief and a lot of anxiety. She just didn't know, like, was there going to be conflict or tension, or was I going to have a consequence or a punishment for not saying yes to everything? But the next day, she held her boundary firmly, reminded her daughter-in-law of the agreed upon pickup time. And she also called her friend to let her know that she had implemented a boundary, held it, and just shared the good news with her. As the weeks went on, Linda noticed significant improvements in her physical and emotional health. She no longer had the same level of dread when she would hear that ping on her phone. Her back pain started to ease, and she felt just a sense of empowerment from taking control for her own time and energy. And Linda's daughter-in-law, even though she was hesitant to begin with, she definitely respected the boundaries, and she even set up alternative childcare options when it was necessary. So deep exhale for Linda, a little round of applause, like amazing job. Now let's talk about how toxic boundaries impact our mental health. Like, toxic boundaries can lead to chronic stress, anxiety, and even physical health issues. So when you're constantly putting other people's needs ahead of your own, it can lead to burnout, and prolonged stress can affect your overall well-being, leading to a range of negative outcomes. Let's first talk about chronic stress. Living with toxic boundaries often means a constant state of stress, worrying about what other people are thinking, worrying about meeting their expectations, and trying to avoid any fallout if you don't follow what they want. This chronic stress can weaken your immune system and increase your risk of various health problems. And besides all that, it ages us faster. Like, basically having toxins just pumping through our body 24/7, just crinkling us. For example, Linda's constant babysitting led to ongoing stress, which manifested emotional exhaustion and physical back pain. Chronic stress can lead to issues like hypertension, heart disease, and other serious health conditions. It is so essential to take steps to lower your stress or not fall into the category as a chronic stress sufferer. Next up, anxiety. The pressure to conform to other people's demands and the fear of conflict can lead to anxiety. You may find yourself overthinking, second guessing everything you do, which I don't know about you, but that leaves me mentally exhausted. And Linda often felt anxious about saying no to her daughter-in-law. She feared conflict, she feared tension, and anxiety can lead to sleep disturbances, digestive problems, and just like a constant state of worry. Addressing the root cause, such as boundary issues, can lead to a significant reduction of anxiety levels. Next, we have physical health issues. Stress and anxiety from toxic boundaries can manifest physically, causing headaches, sleep disturbances, and again, digestive issues and other health problems. The body and mind are so interconnected that prolonged mental stress can significantly impact your physical health. Again, look at Linda and how her back pain worsened due to the physical strain and stress of overcommitting to her family's needs. Physical symptoms like chronic pain, fatigue, and frequent illnesses can also be a sign that your boundaries need some adjustments. Listen to your body. It always gives us a signal when something's wrong. Finally, burnout. Chronically prioritizing other people's needs ahead of your own, it's gonna lead to burnout. And that is a state of emotional, mental, and physical exhaustion. Burnout can make it difficult to function effectively in daily life, affecting your productivity and your relationships. For Linda, the ongoing stress and lack of rest led to burnout, making her less effective at her job, like where she actually got paid. Burnout affects your ability to think clearly, which makes sense, right? I'm emotionally, physically, and mentally exhausted. So I can't think clearly. I'm not productive. I'm sure I'm not making good decisions. And if all this is going on, I'm not maintaining healthy relationships. So taking steps to maintain boundaries is crucial for preventing burnout. One final tip today, and it's probably the most important, is to always trust your gut. If something feels off, it probably is. Don't ignore your feelings. We literally have tons of neurons in our gut that's connected to our brain, and it's communicating all the time. So trust your gut. Remember, setting boundaries is an act of self-respect. When you set your boundaries, it's like setting a bar so that other people know like where to meet it. So you're setting your expectation of treatment. It's very important that you do this. For years, I struggled standing up for myself because I didn't want to make anyone else uncomfortable. But every single time I didn't stand up for myself and I betrayed myself over someone else's comfort level, it made me feel so terrible. And I think back to those days and I'm just so glad I've done the work and now I have healthy boundaries. So trust your gut, set those boundaries, and remember that your well-being is a priority. By doing this, you respect yourself, you show where other people should respect you, and you're gonna live a life more aligned with your values. Until next time, friend, make sure you keep minding your boundaries.